All right, everybody. Part two of Deep Analysis is here today. Hopefully you have the opportunity to listen to Matthew Dilks, Edgar Magayesh, and Tarik Patel yesterday. If you didn't, you can obviously go back and find the podcast on Stitcher, SoundCloud, iTunes, the podcast app, Spotify, and wherever else you do listen to the pod and catch that episode. Today's is a quick one here with Brian Bronduin, who just top-aided Mythic Championship 2 in London and came up a little bit short in Richmond. Ross Merriam, who finished 10-5, unfortunately, for him. And then Peter Ingram, who didn't have a great finish this weekend either. But we had some fun chats talking about the London Mulligan rule and a whole bunch more that I hope you enjoy right now. I love you. I'm with Ross Merriam, Brian Bronduin, newly minted off his Mythic Championship top eight. And
congratulations, by the way.
Pete Ingram. All right, everybody. Hi, Pete. How are you?
What was that?
That was me being nice. That part's going to be edited out. Ross Merriam, Pete Ingram, and the most important man here, BBD, finally able to top eight a Mythic Championship. Oh. Well, when you top eight your Mythic Championship, then you will be more important than BBD. I did it. You can do it. It can happen.
Eh, you were close this time.
No.
I finished 9-7.
No. But I mean, you were like close.
I mean, I was 6-1, which is, if you take the odds of me top eighting that Pro Tour Mythic Championship at any given point at any of them I've ever played, me being 6-1 last weekend in London is probably the highest odds. Because I've once gone into the last five rounds, like the last constructive portion, live for top eight. I was X3 in Hawaii in 2012.
A long time ago. That's when we met. Ugh.
Yeah. Do you think being 8-3 is more likely to top eight than being 6-1?
No.
Yeah. Probably not.
No. But you're better at math than me, so I don't know.
Yeah.
How's it feel, dude?
Feels pretty good.
Does it feel better? So the world thing had to feel better, right?
Yeah.
Than this.
Yeah. Winning worlds definitely felt better than this. But this was like, this kind of felt like a bigger accomplishment in some ways, because it was like people measure everything in Pro Tour top eights, and like top eighting a PT is really difficult. I mean, Worlds is 24 players, so like, you know, anything can happen there. But like when it's 500 players and you have to go like X3 in a 16 round tournament or whatever, it felt like a harder accomplishment, even though it was less meaningful.
Maybe monkey off the back finally.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
People strategy.
Yes.
Just people and more people.
Yeah. Just as many people as I could find. occasionally like Vidoc and Wizards, but mostly just people.
Just take them off the streets. Some of them aren't really people, but they look like people. Yeah. It's hard to tell.
There's somebody like selling fruit at like a vendor's table outside, just grabbed him in.
So when you were thinking like, okay, I'm gonna top eight my first like PT or MC, it's just all people. Was that how you drew it up in your head? It's just 36 creatures or whatever?
I was like, all right, I'm gonna play 19 lands, 4 Aether Vial.
And people.
37 people.
Yeah.
I'm sure in his head he drew it up with some dopey mid-range deck.
Yeah, obviously.
With Orzhov Guildgate. But, you know, in reality, that's not how you get to the Pro Tour top eights.
Were you in London?
I was.
How did we do?
I went 7-9. I lost playing, or no, I went 8-8. I lost playing for 9-7.
What'd you play?
I played Blue Eye Control along with four of my other face-to-face teammates.
Okay. And then Ross, you played as a Phoenix?
Yes.
Yeah, 9-7. All right, first question, because I know the next round's going to start kind of soon. London Mulligan, for or against, starting with Ross?
Ambivalent.
Why are you the way you are?
It just doesn't seem like it has much of an effect. I think it makes you feel like you have control over the games. I'm not sold that it actually does. And even if it does, like, whatever.
All right.
It just doesn't affect. It literally makes no difference about how I do anything approaching to Magic, except when I mulligan, I draw 7.
Okay.
I already do that in Versus Live all the time.
Yeah, that's true. So you're already just used to the London Mulligan.
Yeah, that's the special London Mulligan. You don't have to pull one back.
Peter?
I'm also ambivalent. I feel like
this is great content.
I think that I am for it basically because most of the pros seem to be pretty for it after the Pro Tour. I think it was pretty good for limited, and for modern it made decks like Tron and Dredge obviously slightly better, but only slightly. I don't think it was as bad as people had made it out to be.
It wasn't even good.
I'm concerned for newer players and how difficult the decision is to bottom cards after seeing a 7 for just like when they're learning Magic, basically. But if that is fine, then I'm more or less fine with it.
All right. That seems like a wash with the Scry decision in the Vancouver Mulligan, right?
Well,
it's a more difficult, but not a...
You're looking at one card and you're deciding whether to top it or bottom. That's one decision, basically.
Yeah.
Versus looking... Say you mulligan to 5. Now you have to choose 2 cards to go to the bottom. It obviously...
You're choosing decision out of 7
gets,
as
yeah,
well.
Yeah.
Instead of just looking
decision
at
gets harder
the more times you mulligan. That's true.
BBD?
Well, like, what's the opposite of ambivalent? Like, bivalent or something?
I don't know.
Is that a word?
That might be a word.
Passionate?
Passionate?
Yeah. You're right. For it.
I'm for it. Yeah. Okay. I think it has a much bigger impact than Ross is saying. And I think it reduces, like, significantly reduces non-games for a variety of ways. One is that, like, if you mold a 5, instead of having a 1 land hand and hoping to rip a second, you get to have, like, 2 lands, 3 spells. And then the other is that you're less likely to mull lower because, like, you're less likely to have to mull again your 6 again because you get to see an extra card. Like, you're less likely to mull from 5 to 4 because you get to see, like, 2 extra cards. So it reduces how many times you mull again as well. So I think it just makes for less, like, non-games of Magic. And I think that makes it worth it even if it, like, makes some unfun strategies, like, a little too good.
All right. Most people appear to be mostly for it from who I've talked to so far. You guys were all at the Pro Tour, so I'm going to start with you, Brian, and go back the other way. Open deck list. Let's say, hypothetically, this started to become a thing at like a tournament like this Open you're at, or maybe the Invitational that we're going to have in Roanoke. Like, did you like open deck list? Did you not like open deck list at the Pro Tour?
So I like it because I think it benefits me as a player.
Okay.
I don't know if it's good or bad. I think it's good for it seems like it's good for coverage, getting to like do deck text with people and not have people hiding information. But I don't know if it's like great for the tournament as a whole. But I personally enjoy it because I feel like I get more of an edge off of having all that information than a lot of my opponents do. And maybe I'm wrong by saying that, but that's just how I feel.
PDP.
I feel similarly to BBD. I think that I myself gain a huge edge, and I'm sure many other players do, from knowing the opponent's playing. It was, in fact, a huge factor in me playing Blue-White at the Pro Tour. I felt like I was going to have a bigger edge knowing what my opponent was going to be playing, and I could mulligan to things in the matchup because I was playing a more reactive deck. So I think it gives reactive strategies a upper hand, especially when more linear strategies are being proactive because of the mulligan rule.
Fine. Ambivalent, Ross?
No, I'm very, very passionately pro open deck list.
You're ambivalent.
Yes, ambivalent. I'm highly ambivalent, super ambivalent.
Okay.
Less so because I think I get an edge, I think I do because I'm pretty good at just parsing all the information and remembering all of it during the match and then adjusting. So I like that. That's not actually a big factor as to why I like it. I just hate scouting and any incentive to do it because it's this tiny edge that you put in a ton of work to get and you feel really bad whenever you don't try to get it because you know it's just there and it's pretty obvious how to do it. It's just very tedious. And anything that reduces that kind of tedium is great. So just submit to deck list early. I think they should just post every single deck list the day before the Pro Tour. I think that would be worse for like foreign Pro Tours and Pro Tours where some people like won't have access to that immediately when they look at their pairings. So they'll still have to do the awkward, everybody has their, you know, slip with their deck list on it, hand it to each other. Like that swap is awkward. I like to avoid it, but I'm not sure there's a good way around it. But any way to just put the information out of the open, just arm people with information and let them do what they will with it.
I want to add to that like if they throw the information out in the open, which I also agree that they should do that the day before, then you run into people can tweet about their decks and stuff and not feel bad about it. Like in this tournament, I didn't want to tweet out my deck because the first round of Constructed was without deck lists. Like just make them all be with deck lists instead of having one random round without it.
Sideboard.
And then I can tweet that I'm playing humans and like here's my deck and stuff and it's not like a big deal. Whereas now, like, I don't want to spew equity in exactly round 4, even though it kind of feels stupid.
Yeah. See, I actually like it where I wish everything was open, and then it's a big deal if there's a tournament with closed deck lists. right? Like, yeah, we're so used to everything being closed, and then, like, when it's open, it's like, whoa, this is weird. Like, imagine everything is open always, then, like, when you play in Worlds, it's like, closed deck list, this tournament's extra hard. I think that would be kind of cool.
That's great.
Yeah, that sounds awesome.
A player championship doing that would be awesome.
Yeah.
If things go that way.
I think I think we've been doing it in reverse for a long time.
Yeah, I think.
But, and there's, like, a lot of upkeep, because it's, like, you know, a bunch of paper and stuff. Like, if we did it at every open, it's, like, a lot of... There's a lot of rounds, a lot of pairings. That's, like, kind of a lot. You know, like, if we have, like, a 900-person open, it's like, God, we got to print off every deck list for every person. And they have to do the exchange, and, like, probably adds a lot more time to the tournament.
Tell people to submit their deck list on Thursday night and then put Nick Miller to work.
just him by himself.
Yep, okay. In a closet.
I'll pass this along.
With a desk and really cool. A 1984 Apple computer.
And a flashlight.
Next round, pairings are up.
Pairings are up?
Yeah.
All right, what's your record?
7-1.
Esper Hero?
Yep.
Record?
5-3, Esper Control.
Ross?
6-2, Esper Hero.
Do you like your deck, Ross?
I like the archetype. I think my version is misbuilt. I think I need to go a little bit bigger. BBD, I think, goes too big, but I prefer a minus a little bigger than it is.
Do you like your deck, Pete?
I'm medium on it. I think the Nexus matchup needs work. It's tough.
Do you like your deck, Brian?
Yeah, I think it's great, and I like going bigger with the deck. I disagree with Ross that I went too big. So.
You never go too big.
Yeah, you never go too big. Yeah, it's just not possible.
That's Ross, Brian, and Pete. They're going to go play round 9, all going to win, and they're going to make day 2. That's it.
Well, as we know, unfortunately, none of the three players in Peter, Brian, or Ross made the top 8 after their pairings went up that round, but always fun to get to chat with them. Tomorrow, gonna have a fun chit-chat with Jim Davis. No spoilers this time. It's actually a conversation I really enjoyed that I think you all will really like as well. Love chatting with Jim, longtime friend. So happy for him and his success in Magic over the past handful of years as he fully dove in and dedicated himself. So look forward to that tomorrow. And of course, you can rate and review over on iTunes. You can subscribe there too, along with Stitcher, SoundCloud, Spotify, all the S's, the podcast app. You can become a patron at patreon.com/thecedricphillipspodcast as well. All done for today. We'll see you tomorrow with DJ JD, and Jewel Vera will play us out. Baby.